والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء سيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم إلى قيامة يوم الدين. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله. السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله يا غريب كربلاء. رزقنا الله في الدنيا زيارتكم وشفاعتكم في الدنيا وفي القبر وفي الآخرة. أما بعد، فقد قال الله في محكم كتابه وقرآنه المجيد وقوله الحق: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ومن الناس من يتخذ من دون الله أندادا يحبونهم كحب الله، والذين آمنوا أشد حبا لله، ولو يرى الذين ظلموا إذ يرون العذاب أن القوة لله جميعا وأن الله شديد العقاب. إذ تبرأ الذين اتبعوا من الذين اتبعوا ورأوا العذاب وتقطعت بهم الأسباب. وقال الذين اتبعوا لو أن لنا كرة فنتبرأ منهم كما تبرأوا منا. كذلك يريهم الله أعمالهم حسرات عليهم وما هم بخارجين من النار. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلى الله على محمد وعلى محمد. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The ayat that I just quoted or recited from Surah Al-Baqarah are some interesting ayat that have to do with our lives today as much as they did 1400 years ago when they were freshly revealed. What do they mean? For reference, this is ayat 165 to 167 from Surah Al-Baqarah. We start off with وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُونَ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. But among mankind there are some people who dare to take partners with Allah. A nid is someone who you equate to another person or another entity in any way, shape, and form. Now the Quran is full of warnings and condemnations of shirk. But here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not concerned with who the ma'bud is. He doesn't care here about who is being worshipped. It's not the religion that matters over here. Because as we'll see in a few words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. The problem over here is they love these people, these entities, these beings, كحب الله, with the love that they should have had for Allah. And this is something that we're going to have to come back to, this concept of the hub of Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing full well how this ummah is going to turn out, gives us a phrase that really shakes us to our core. But we'll come back to that, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here that the problem is not what they worship, rather it is what they love. And this love is now distracting them from, presumably, the commands of Allah. What Allah has asked them to do, they're not doing it, because something else has taken priority. And now we come to that statement that I mentioned, that Allah left for us to ponder about, that really, for those who have that connection with Allah, who know what type of connection they should have with Allah, it really shakes us. What is that phrase? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. But it's okay, as for those who believe, أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. That no matter what they have as a love, and we'll look at many, many different examples today. I've noted quite a few down, and we'll go through some of them and some of, you know, the practical applications that we see in our youth, in our middle age, and in our elders. From the obvious to the less obvious, to the even unconscious people. And yet, this level of devotion and level of commitment, Allah says, don't worry, the people who are الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ, that even stronger than their hub for these other things, the people who believe, their hub is even stronger for Allah. How many of us, and we'll see some of the examples, ask yourself as I give each example, inshallah, tonight, and keep this phrase in mind with that question. Do I actually have love for Allah the same way how some other people, or maybe even myself, I myself have love for some of these things? Does Allah take precedence in my life, or do these things? Inshallah, that will be the first ayah that we look at. And then I want to look at what are those other things going to say to us. And this is the only part of the majlis, inshallah, tonight that I'll be covering for these two ayat. So let's get started. Ayah number 166, again, the Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter of the Quran, is إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا. And over here, this word in is a connector to the previous ayah, meaning only we could see the moment when what, Ya Allah? إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ. Now everybody here, I believe, knows what tabarra means, right? Tabarra means that you want to have nothing to do with this concept or personality or idea. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ تُبِعُوا. The ones who were followed are going to do tabarra of all their followers. الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوا وَرَأَوُ الْعَذَابِ. And then you see a plural, وَرَأَوُ. All of them will see the adab, meaning both. The followed and the followers will both see the torture of Allah standing right in front of them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابُ. All ties, all relations between them will be absolutely severed. No one will want to have anything to do with each other. Which tabarra was already clear enough. But now Allah is taking it even a step further, that they don't want to even have the least amount to do with their followers. وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابُ. Then we come to ayah 167. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا. And the people who were following, they will say, لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً. We just had another chance. Meaning, we only had a second chance to come into dunya. فَنَتَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُمْ كَمَا تَبَرَّأُوا مِنَّا. The same way that they want nothing to do with us, if we got a second chance in dunya, we would also be like, you know what? Now that I've got clarity, I would have nothing to do with you. I don't want anything to do with you. Why is the reason that Allah is telling us this? So that right now, realizing that there is no such thing as a second chance at dunya, take action now. Do tabarra of these things, some of the things that I've, you know, written down as, you know, some of my notes as a cultural observer. I just kind of see things and I write things down. That'll be good for us. Take action now. Do tabarra now. Don't wait and then fall under the presumption that there will be a second chance for him, because there are no second chances. As anybody who's read the Quran, who's been in this religion for 5 minutes, will tell you, there are no second chances. You have this one chance, and then you have the result. As Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam says, that this dunya is a reality and a realm where there is only action and no reward. And tomorrow will be reward and no action. So take advantage of the time that you have left and take these ayat to heart. Take what I'm saying to you in these 8 nights and reflect on it for now. But once Muharram is done, similar to how we do with Shahr Ramadan, and we say, well, the other 11 months are also for Allah, come back and revisit these lectures and ask yourself, what did I learn in these 8, 10, 13 lectures? What have I learned? What can I go and take away from this? Because these are things that we need reminders of constantly. And then we see that after they say, if only we had a chance so that we could also go and have nothing to do with them, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَذَلِكَ يُرِيهِمُ اللَّهُ أَعْمَالُهُمْ حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ. This is how Allah will go and show them all of their previous actions as an embarrassment, as something that they will, you know, when you have hasar, you deeply regret. I mean, we all sometimes have some things like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm going to have to see that on Qiyamah. I was just a little kid. I can't believe I was, for example, so annoying. I can't believe I was such a chatterbox. I can't believe I used to say that. I can't believe, for example, some of us who don't go anymore, we don't curse, we don't swear. But back in the day, when maybe we used to have a, you know, more looser tongue, now that embarrasses us. Right? Now we, alhamdulillah, have come to a cleaner path. Or maybe some of us have not come to a cleaner path. And inshallah, we can one day move towards that. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Please, brothers, move away from the bench and distribute yourselves amongst over here so that I'm not looking at one side. Please, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. A second one for the love of the Imam of our time. Ponder on them. If you don't have notes with you right now like how I do, I don't usually lecture with notes, but there are just so many examples and so many things to keep in mind and juggle, it's not feasible to memorize these. And so therefore I have notes. So take the example from me and start using notes. And we see that this will be a source of deep regret for them. Wow, how did I waste so much time doing this and worrying about these things, and I wasn't worrying about the reality of things of this dunya, worrying about my full-time retirement plan, my long-term retirement plan, which is akhirah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very, I know most of us are not Arab, and so I'll dissect the grammar without going into the grammar. وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ. Here, هُمْ is مُقَدَّم, meaning especially these people. And we'll see how well we as mu'mineen fall out of or into this categorization of hum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, especially these people, even if they think that they're mu'mineen, then no, hell is not going to be for us. وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ. Especially them, and even them, I want you to pay attention to how does Allah review, because he says ma and bi. There is no stronger form of negation in the Quran. Absolutely not. Don't even let the thought come into your mind that there is even an iota of shafa'ah for these people, of a chance for these people. بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ. So that they will be the people who ever exit. With that scary introduction in mind, let's go through some of our observations. First of all, in the ayah of 165, which is going to be the carrying on ayah, which underscores the rest of our discussion, we see that we start off with hub, which is love. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Why then does Allah move from hub to وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ عَذَابَ أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ جَمِيعًا. This yara over here is consideration, knowledge, thinking. Why does Allah switch from feeling and loving to thinking? In fact, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you probably read in the Quran a lot of times, why don't they think with their hearts sometimes, right? Like, why is the heart, like, we think with our brains, right? But a lot of times the Quran will use the word qalb, and then the translator has no choice but to go and put the word heart. Why? Let me give you some examples. A teenager who, God forbid, does drugs. Let's not even say drugs. Let's say he smokes. What does this person do? This person, let's say in high school, he is very intelligent. In all of his exams, especially in PE, in physical health, he gets A pluses. And he knows that smoking is bad for him. But what does he do in his room, closed bedroom, when parents aren't looking? He's taking out his cigarettes from underneath his bed or from underneath a plant or whatever, living in the bathroom. And he's got the window open so that it doesn't sink up his room. He's got all of the air fresheners. I'm not speaking from experience, I just have a very creative imagination. And I happen to, astaghfirullah, watch TV, so I know this is a common thing where people hide smoking from their parents. So what does this kid do? He knows that smoking is bad for him. Meaning he knows up here, but over here he's not convinced in his heart. But if his parents pull up in the driveway, and he hears the car, or he hears the footsteps coming up the stairs, or down the hallway, or the knock is coming on the door, oh, how he'll move quickly. Go and put it out, throw it out, throw out all the evidence, cover up with some Glade or Febreze. This majlis is not sponsored, by the way. That's when he knows what his heart contains. It's not the khutbah of the Surgeon General on the pack of every cigarette box that this can kill you. That's not what's going to convince him. What convinces him is, Dad's going to be really mad at me. Mom's going to kill me. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he knows us. He puts qalb instead of aql so many times in. And that's why there's the shift. That if only they had with their hearts come to thinking like this about Allah. If only they were that convinced about Allah. Another example would be someone who, maybe he's even a lawyer. He gets people out of speeding tickets. But what does he do? He speeds. Until he sees on the side of the highway, or his Google Maps, or his Waze will go and tell him that there's a speed trap. Right? Maybe some of us do this. So this is something that we know and we do in our day-to-day lives. But then, coming back to وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Sometimes, as we'll see in our day-to-day lives, especially for the youth, maybe we'll have friends who come and invite us to parties that we know that we shouldn't be attending. And we're at the risk of losing those friends. That, hey, if you don't come downstairs right now, I'm here to pick you up, then you're not even my friend anymore. Don't expect to talk to me anymore. And you say, oh, it's okay, it's fine, because you have ashaddu hubba lillah. You have a greater love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, you are okay with losing friends, because what did you gain instead? As Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Says in Dua Arafah, what has the one who gained you lost, and what has the one who lost you gained? Truly, if you've lost Allah, what can you possibly gain that can ever replace Allah? And if you gain Allah, what is there more that you could ever want in your life? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّ لِلَّهِ. Ask yourselves as we now go through these various examples. And the way how I've organized these is from the most obvious to perhaps the least obvious, inshallah. What are some of the things that our youth very obviously have such a hope for that it can even come under this ayah that يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. Music and musicians. These. And sometimes it's even the adults. Don't think that I don't notice when, or the Maulanas don't notice when the older generation, they try to get away with it. Well, it's not as bad as the current generation. We're just listening to some Bollywood songs. Or we're just listening to Lata Mangeshkar, right? Or whoever. And we go crazy that if they happen to be in town and they're giving a live concert, then mashallah, our communities are in much better attendance in those majalis than in these. They go and clear out their schedules. They make sure that they're there early. What a concept that you're there early for a majlis. And then our teenagers will even have posters of singers. They'll go crazy for them. I was once waiting, and this is not even for musicians, but this is for comedians. I won't mention the entire situation because then it'll become way too obvious and he might be listening, and so I don't want to put him on the spot. But there is a friend of mine who I was waiting for him for a very, very long time, and eventually he stopped ignoring me because he was trying on Ticketmaster. This is while I was getting my hair cut. There, I gave it away, sorry. Before I came here. And he's on Ticketmaster, trying to get tickets for a comedian. And he's telling me the entire time what the price is that he had to pay for this comedian's, you know, tickets. Just to, and it's not haram. It's before Muharram. Perfectly fine. But imagine if you needed to go and pay hundreds of dollars to have a seat over here for the Majlis of Abba Abdullah. How many of us would pay? Can we say, reflecting on that line, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّ لِلَّهِ, that they have a greater, stronger love for Allah. Can you honestly say that you would pay $500, $700 to get front row seats? I have to go and, for free, people come over here, ask people for, with a loud salawat to please come closer. With a comedian, with a dancer, with a singer, with an NBA game, with an NFL game. We want the front row seats. We want courtside tickets. And do you think any of these musicians, comedians, athletes care about us as much as we care about them? Do you think LeBron James even knows your name? Inshallah, LeBron James listens to my majlis. But this isn't where it ends. There are singers who, you know, I'm not off of social media. I know their names. Selena Gomez, The Weeknd, some of the weirdest names sometimes, and even weirder hairstyles. But we idolize them. We go to the barbershops and the hair salons. We want to have their hairstyles. And we don't care as much about Allah, do we? Do they care about us? Do we realize that when the Quran promises us that they will want to have nothing to do with us, All they want to brag about is the number of followers they have on Instagram, the number of followers they have on TikTok, and on more archaic social platforms like Twitter. How many followers do you have? That's all you are to them. You are a statistic, you are a number. And even if you unfollow them tonight, if everyone here and everyone listening to my majlis unfollows them tonight, they won't care. Even if it drops by 0.01 million, what do they care? Are they going to lose sleep? If they lose all of their followers on Twitter or whatever, as long as they still have their deals with the recording agencies, as long as they're still in Hollywood, do they really care? Do they know you by name? Are they going to ask about your health if you get sick? Oh, but if their wife gets sick, if their husband, if their kid has something as simple as, you know, like, what's that skin disease? Like, if they have a little bit of, like, you know,
Eczema,
yes. If the kid has eczema, we share the article everywhere, we care. They don't care about us. And you will be shown how many hours and days and weeks you put into this devotion towards them, such that you could have almost built them a dhariq and a shrine out of how much love you have for them. And you will be shown this on the Day of Judgment, and this will be a hasarat. Because all of these hours you could have been doing, I don't know, something useful, like making up your qada' salah. Learning that you have deficiencies in your prayer, such that you know now, I have qada' now that I have to make up of my fasting, of my prayers, of whatever. How much better usage of time would that be, that you can look back on Yawm al-Qiyamah and say, well, at least I wasn't doing something like when I was much younger. When I was 13, and at least now when I'm 15, I'm here sitting in the majlis of Abu Abdullah. What else, brothers and sisters? We see so many of these examples in our day-to-day lives, in our communities, in high schools. How many brothers and sisters have someone that we know is in high school, or we ourselves are in high school? And we think that, you know, we're not in school like in Pakistan or in Saudi Arabia or in Iran or in Syria or wherever. But the school systems over here are just as much enslaved as you think that you are back home. Over there, back home, maybe you have to stand up. You greet your teacher with "Assalamu alaikum, teacher." Maybe something like that, right? Here, can you imagine our kids standing up for your teacher? The teacher is over here talking and the kids are talking. There's not a care in the world. But what they are conditioned to do and what they are enslaved to do is when it comes to clicks. If my friends all have a tattoo, I need to have a tattoo, because otherwise I'm the one who's left out. If all of my friends listen to a certain type of music, and even if I don't like that music, I need to fit in with this type of friends. They're the cool kids. They're the ones who I want to hang, because otherwise I don't want to be a social pariah. I don't want to be left out. I don't want to be a loner. I don't want to be called names. I want to have a clique that will come and defend me. And the religious kids, they're picked on too much. They're the people who, you know, they don't have anything really cool going on. They don't play Minecraft. They don't play, you know, League of Legends, whoever and whatever these games are. The religious kids are just not cool. And so high school is an arena of so much social pressure that our kids, we don't even know what kind of battlefields we are sending them into. And they come back and we're wondering, why are they wearing these kinds of clothes? Why are they asking me, oh, I need to have this type of backpack. And if I don't have this type of backpack, I'm gonna die. It's because they want to fit in. This is the thing that they love so much. They're loving this. They are so entrenched in love with this. This is the type of love that they should have reserved only for Allah. Only and only for Allah. And of course, the representatives of Allah. It's not a problem if we love Rasulullah like this, because who is he other than someone who takes us back to Allah? It's not a problem if we love Ahlul Bayt like this, because what is Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib other than someone who takes us back constantly to Allah? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
second louder salawats for the love of Imam al-Hussein.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So we see that this is something that, it's not just the youth that have to deal with this. This is something that we see in our work. Those of us who are employed, we have a 9-to-5 job, yes? How many of us have felt the pressure that the Christmas party is coming, you have to be there, because if you're the one person in your corporation who doesn't show up, whatever your reason is, you don't want to be there because there's dancing, because there's inappropriate clothing, because there's what? Because there's alcohol? It's okay, you don't have to drink, just come anyway. Or maybe, you are pressured to come to team building events. But hey, we're all meeting up a little bit after work so that we can all have a better team. We all work together closely. SubhanAllah, whenever I'm asked to come to these things, it's never an innocent place like a pizza place, you know, somewhere where I can go. It's consistently, month after month, a bar. Now what am I supposed to do? A Maulana is supposed to go to the bar? No, it's okay, you don't have to go and drink. They have, you know, something that you can just have water over there. You can just have a tuna sandwich. Really? I'm going to have a tuna sandwich in a bar? I'm going to be giving my money, my halal rizq, to a haram establishment? Are you sure? You want to rethink it? You want to rethink that? Who you're saying it to? Are you sure? Because my hope for Allah is not going to be questioned by the likes of you. How many of us can say that? That when we go to work, I can say, Allah is my razaq. And أَنَّ الْقُوَّةِ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Remember, we just read that in the ayah. That all power truly belongs with Allah. Not this one who I think is my razaq, but that actual razaq. That even if I lose this job because they say, oh, he's not a team player. You know, he doesn't really come to the outings with us. He's not really eligible for the promotions at work. Johnny is. Brad is. Etc., etc. The Hindu who's okay with drinking, he is. The Buddhist. All of these guys are okay. But you are now thinking, my God, but my career is on the line. My career advancement is on the line. I'm new in the career and I need to advance. Surely Allah is not going to punish me if I don't even drink. I don't even have the want to drink. Brothers and sisters, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? He says, "Udkhulu fi sinni kaffa." Enter into Islam wholeheartedly. Do not go down the footsteps of shaytan. Not just don't follow shaytan, don't follow the footsteps. What is the footsteps of shaytan other than, I'm just taking the girl's number so that I can ask her for homework. Right, homework. Because there's no other students in your class, there's no males. You're sure that you need this sister's. And for the sisters, you're sure you need this brother's number for homework? Why are you hanging out so much? I don't see really any homework being done. Your grades are the worst of the entire class. I don't know, maybe this is something from the dinosaur age. Maybe our kids, they're saying, Maulana, we don't know what you're talking about. This is something we don't even understand. But somehow I doubt that. How many of us are willing to put our livelihoods on the line and say, Allah will look after me and take care of me, even if I don't go to all of their haram gatherings? If it's a perfectly fine gathering, if it's a pizza place, if it's a bowling alley, if it's a, you know, if it's at someone's house, and you can go and even offer them some alternatives. Look, you know, I want to be a part of this team building thing, but I also value my religion. You would be surprised in today's liberal world how much they respect this. But we, thinking that we are outcasts, that people don't want to accommodate to Islam, we don't even want to bring it up. You'll be surprised how many of them are willing to accommodate and they won't even think wrong of you. Offer them the alternative. Say, come to my house. My wife, or in these generations, I myself will probably have to cook. I'll cook for you guys if my wife doesn't. I'll give you some nice, you guys think that I like tuna sandwiches? I'll show you some tuna sandwiches. I'll show you some biryanis and some masala and all of this kind of stuff. Right? Why do we have to go and seed the ground when it comes to this territory, when it comes to haram environments, when it comes to our workplaces? And how many of us are willing to let that go? That's why, brothers and sisters, when you go, inshallah, and look for this lecture again, it'll be under the title of sacrificing our cultural mindsets for the malakut. And we'll get to the malakut. What is the malakut? We'll get to it, inshallah. But it requires sacrifice. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. In high schools, in workplaces, you often find this pressure where now you have to dress like how they dress. You have to walk like they walk. Have you ever noticed sometimes your kid is walking with a little bounce in their step and you're like, where did you learn this? Oh, it's because the cool kids do that, right? Where did you learn this kind of vocabulary? Oh, it's from these people at work. يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ They have a love that is rivaling what should have been only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Something else in our high schools. Now, alhamdulillah, in my high school, this was not so much of a problem. But I don't trust the West to be as kind as it was to me, to all of you. In our high schools, there are proms. And we say, oh, but you have to go to the prom. Don't dance, it's okay. But at least, you know, it's an event where you can see all of your friends dressed up. Really, are you sure? That when you're sending your kid, that all they're doing is just dressing up? Are you sure that they're not living a double lifestyle? Are you sure that they're not going to be coming home late? Not much more has to be said from the minbar. I think everybody understands. Then there's something scary amongst our youth. And this is going as far back as 10 years ago, something that I was seeing amongst middle schoolers. And 10 years ago, I'm now past even my 10-year mark of high school graduation. This is something that I noticed long after I had already graduated high school. That this is something, apparently, that is happening with middle schoolers. That by a certain age, if we could close that door, there's a little bit of noise. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. By a certain age, by 11, by 12, sometimes by 10, you have to have done something inappropriate with the other gender. And I know some parents are going to ask me, Maulana, why are you talking about these things from the minbar? If I'm not going to expose these things from the minbar, then this minbar becomes like that minbar in Sham, which Imam Zain al-Abidin called just piles of wood. From the minbar of Hussein, you point out what is wrong with the community. You call for action. And from the minbar of Hussein, we need to notice that our youth is in dire trouble. Where they are under such peer pressure, we think that it's just homework. And at that age, what do they really have to worry about? They have such a battlefield that you didn't even, in your wildest dreams, think that this could be possible at that young age. But if we're not involved in our kids' lives, in our schools, this is why, I mean, COVID presented us the perfect opportunity. How many parents now have switched to homeschooling because they can't trust the public school education? They can't trust what is being taught these days with regards to transgenderism and sexual orientations. And stuff that is being taught to kindergartners. When we take a hands-off approach and we want to be the cool parents, or we just say, well, they're taking care of that aspect, I'll take care of this aspect. You have no idea what kind of slaughterhouse you're sending your kid into. But then we move on to some even less obvious cultural norms that the ayah is definitely criticizing. يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ That they have such a strong love, that that this should have been only for Allah. But if only they could see on the day of judgment when those people who are followed will be completely doing tabarra of those who they had as followers. They said, I have nothing to do with you. I want nothing to do with you. I have my own nafs to think about because I've already done enough damage. And we've already seen what kind of damage are singers doing to our social psyche, these musicians and athletes with all of the things that they're promoting, whether it's in the endorsements that they do or whether it's in the political arena. Are these the types of heroes that we should have plastered over our kids' bedrooms? That these are their heroes? But it's not just the kids, brothers and sisters. My criticism and we'll call it observations. My observations also range to those who are older than me. And it's sad. Let me, for those of us who have come into the majalis a little bit late, first of all, let's move up a little bit closer. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. All of us, please move a little bit closer. The ayat that we recited were وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ ayah 165 through 167 of Baqarah. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا. That they are taking partners to Allah, but it's not worship here that's the problem, it's their love that is distracting them from what Allah needs you to do, and now this becomes something equivalent. يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ الْعَذَابِ. When if only they could see the torture of the hellfire in front of them. أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. That all this time, the power really belonged all this time to Allah. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعَذَابِ. And He is definitely very, very harsh when it comes to torture. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ اتُّبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا وَرَأَوُوا الْعَذَابَ وَتَقَطَّعَتْ بِهِمُ الْأَسْبَابُ. If only they could see the moment when all these idols and their heroes, these musicians, these athletes, these high school people who are setting the trends, and all of the other examples that I will be setting inshallah tonight, if only they could see when all these people will want to have nothing to do with them, and all of them together are looking at hell impending as their destination. Then we see the most scary. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا. And all those followers who were following blindly, they will say, لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً. If only we could have a second chance in dunya. فَنَتَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُمْ. We would also dissociate from them, just like today, how they are dissociating from us. كَمَا تَبَرَّأَ مِنَّا. كَذَلِكَ يُرِيهِمُ اللَّهُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ. This is how Allah will show them these embarrassing pasts of theirs. And look how many hours and days and weeks you went to getting these concert tickets. Look how many years you spent going after these cliques, after these high school norms, and the other examples that I'm about to go through. Look how long you went after these instead of using your time wisely. Look how long you went after your corporate promotion, and you went after, oh, but I have to go to the team building event. I have to go to the Christmas party where there will be dancing and there will be people who are inappropriately dressed and there's alcohol. All of these things will be embarrassments to us because we couldn't take a stand because Allah wasn't priority number one in our lives. And the final and most scary part of these ayahs, that وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ. These people especially, even if they think they're mu'mineen, they're Muslims, if they think that they're getting out of the adab, they especially will be the ones who never, never leave hell. So, what is my next example? Marriage standards. And this is where we go to something less obvious and something from our older generations. Of log kya kahenge? What will people say? If my son marries a convert, if my daughter marries a different nationality, if my son marries someone who is a little bit older, 6 months older, 1 year older, 2 years older, what will all of my friends say? And because of this, not knowing how hard our youth have it already, how hard they have it, how the internet is always giving them suggestive ideas, how the TV is always giving them suggestive ideas, how school is always giving them suggestive ideas. When they're at university, they see all types of women, they see all types of men. And now when they are trying to go and take the halal route, you are pushing them back towards shaitan. How? Because you are saying, yeah, but this halal option, it's a little bit embarrassing because, you know, what, we couldn't find a better bahu, we couldn't find a better daughter-in-law. We had to go and find you're already, mashallah, 30 years old, but she's 31. So haram, she already is having a hard time finding a spouse, but now you are going to add on to her hardship by denying her a good match? Oh, she's not young. She won't be able to bear children. This disgusting kind of commentary in our communities. I've already read to you the ayat. You decide if you want to stop it now or if you're going to be embarrassed on Yawm al-Qiyamah, and then you're going to be told, وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ. I'm saying it loudly. That this is something that will end up in hellfire and it will never be able to leave hellfire. صَلُّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَى That after marriage, you have to live with your parents. It's okay, we have a very nice furnished basement. You can live over there. Okay, fine, the daughter, she can go and live. But the sons, they have to stay with us. Have their first kid with us. Have their second kid with us. Live with us. How many do you know that are trapped in these kinds of situations where they want to move out, they want to finally be able to avoid the constant criticism that comes from the elders? Doesn't have to even be mom and dad. Mom and dad could also be the victims of this same mentality, because mother-in-law and father-in-law have to stay with us. Where else are they going to go? The stigmas that we have against nursing homes, a second house, put them over there. Go and just, in their current house, just go and fund them. No, 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 they have to live with us. That's noble from one perspective, but at the same time, a hardship on everybody else in the household. And now those comments, oh, how they will come from the older generation towards the newer generation. This is the type of hijab that you wear? At least they're trying. This is the type of friends you hang out with? Why? Will you have someone better for me? Do you know who the people are, who I'm avoiding and who I'm choosing wisely? Oh, this is how you talk to your parents? Well, did you see how they talk to me? Not that that's an excuse, brothers and sisters, but some, like we said, in our cancel culture, some of the elders have a criticism for everything. And this is detrimental to mental health. I will say it right now. It's detrimental to mental health. So when we have, oh, you couldn't find a job? You had to go and find a job through your father-in-law? Oh, you're working at your father-in-law's company? And then the comments that some of our cultures have, oh, what kind of a man is this? I challenge any of those people to go and say those kinds of comments towards Nabi Musa. Nabi Musa is the only marriage story that we have in the Quran. And when he gets married, what does his father-in-law say to him? That you will, as dowry, as repayment, because you're a fugitive, you don't have money, even though you were a prince, come and work for me, you can build up a livelihood, I'll give you housing for 8 to 10 years, whichever one you want, 8 or 10 years. And Musa says, okay. Musa also happens to be built like a bodybuilder. I challenge you to make that kind of comment again without thinking of Musa, because now you're going to be making that comment about Musa. Oh, Musa, what kind of a man is he? He has to go and work for his father-in-law after marriage? Look how Allah goes and breaks the stereotypes. And look how we, in our ignorance of Quran and Ahlul Bayt, cling onto them for dear life. Then I want to take you now to two historical examples of those who stood up to their cultures. The first one is Ashab al-Kahf. Those youth who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so proud of. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدًى. No doubt about it, the level of iman that they had, and they were youth. They were preteens. They were not even at the age of teenagehood. They were preteens. Maybe some of them were teenagers, but not much older than that. And they were able to go in front of the Greek community, the Hellenistic community. By the way, which gods do the Greeks worship? Zeus, Poseidon, Hades, all these ones who we see in pop culture, and we think, oh yeah, that's cool. There are youth who once upon a time had their lives threatened because they said, we will only worship the Lord who is Lord of Samawat wal Ard. Not that there is a Rabb for the Samawat and there's a Rabb for the Ard. That Zeus is only the god of the skies and the thunder and blah, 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 and Poseidon is the god of the seas. And what are you talking about, man? There's one god for all of this. And they said, look, you guys are youth. Take some time. You'll have about like a week or 2 weeks. We're going to bring you into the public setting again. We're going to ask you if you have changed your beliefs. And we have a raqim over here. We have a stone tablet where we have your names inscribed. And we have the sentence. Sentenced to death by stoning. If you don't change your religion, you will be stoned to death. And what do? They said, we're not going to give this up. What can we do? We're just going to have to run away. The plan wasn't to go and sleep in a cave. The cave was just their initial meetup. Then they happened to be sleepy. And then they wake up after maybe 100 years or so. But the problem with our communities is we take this story and we take the wrong things to focus on. We're so obsessed with this ayah that seemingly, but doesn't really, say, oh, they stayed in their cave for 300 plus 9. Actually, the way how it's worded is, ثَلَاثَ مِئَةٍ سِنِينَ وَزْدَادُ تِسْعَةٍ. If you go and linguistically, literally translate that, it means 300 years plus 9. Aren't there easier ways to go and say 309 years? Meaning something's off. It's not 309 years. Even if you look at history, it's closer to about 100 years. Oh, wait. Oh. Talk to me after, okay? The fact that they even slept for years, isn't that a miracle? How does that happen? It's because when you have Allah on your side, all of the universe will come and aid you. You can go to sleep and not die for 100 or more years. And you will survive. And you will not be stoned. Why? Because you had a resolute stance. Now, I don't have a community who worships Zeus or Poseidon or Hades. But I do have a community that worships your corporate job, worships high school cliques. I do have a community in front of me that worships marriage standards, that has all different kinds of, and because of this ye log kya kahenge, because of this type of mentality, I don't know how many people will actually be saved from Jahannam. Inshallah, Allah saves us all. Jahannam is not an easy place to even talk about. But when you don't have that kind of pre-knowledge, that foreknowledge from Quran, what do you expect? This is why Quran was sent, so that we can go and fix our lives. But when all it's reduced to is something that we go and put over our heads at the nikah, thinking that through osmosis, inshallah, some barakah will come down and trickle down to us. That's all it is. What is it going to guide us towards? إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ. Well, how am I supposed to get to أَقْوَمُ if I don't even read it? If I don't even know what I'm saying in my namaz? Second example. And we're close to the end. Second example would actually be Prophet Musa's mother. Look how she has that resoluteness because she knows that she has a Rabb who will take care of her child. Otherwise, you tell me, brothers and sisters, especially the brothers, have you ever been to the beach with your toddler and you try to take them into the water and mom is calling after them? No, not my child. Don't go and take her into the water. Even if it's a little bit of bath water, the shallowest amount of bath water, because you don't want anything to go wrong with your child. Now answer me this. How is this mother putting her baby into a basket and putting him into a turbulent Nile River with crocodiles, with stones? Any which way that this basket could turn spells death. How does she do that? It's because she has firm belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My next example is Prophet Ibrahim and his uncle. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ آزَرَ أَتَتَّخِذُ أَصْنَامًا آلِهَةً إني أراك وقومك في ضلال مبين. He says to his uncle Azar, or his stepfather Azar, if we want to take a little bit more of a closer translation to Abi, إني أراك في إني أراك وقومك في ضلال مبين. In that time, the source of respect, the source of authority, especially in the household, is the father. The father is the head of the household. And where does he derive that stature and that station from? From his society. Ibrahim alayhi salam, at a young age, comes up to his father and says, "You want me to go and worship your idols? You go and make idols." No doubt, and he goes and says, "In me, no doubt about it. I am saying it to your face. Inni araka wa qawmaka. I see you and the source that gives you power. Fi dalalin mubin. You are drowning in all types of dalal, of misguidance." And this, brothers and sisters, is not an easy thing to say. This isn't just like saying, "Oh, your favorite game is Monopoly, my favorite game is chess. Oh, but Ayatollah Sistani says no to chess." This isn't a small thing. This type of conversation takes guts. Why? Because the types of thing that I am mentioning in my majalis, like transgenderism, do you know what this could do to my career? I could be canceled. Ibrahim could likewise be canceled. You think he cares? You know why I know his people care? Because as soon as he says this, after the ayah that I'm about to go through right now, he's about to have his famous sarcasm. "Oh, the star, it's out tonight. Maybe this is my God. Oh, it's gone? I guess not, huh, guys? Oh, the moon, that's much bigger. Maybe this is my God. Oh, wait, no, it's gone. Guys, I think this might not be my God. Wow, look at the sun. This must be my actual God." And then it sets, it's like, you know, "Inni wajjahtu wajhiya lilladhi fatara as-samawati wal ard." I have now turned my face exclusively. This is one of the most intelligent beings in our human history. And you think he believes for a second that the star, the moon, and the sun might have been gods? Interestingly, in the excavations around Ur, there are three major idols that turned up. And on their crowns, one of them has a sun, one of them has a moon, and one of them has a star. And he's going after the biggest idols of their time. And when you go after an idol, whether it's the sun god, the moon god, and the star god, or whether it's LGBT, whether it's your high school clique, whether it's your corporation, whether it's whatever it is, expect backlash. It's not going to be easy. It wasn't easy for Ashab al-Kahf. You think a death sentence for an 11-year-old and maybe 5 friends, 6 friends, 7 friends, 8 friends, 9 friends, you think that's easy to go and see, "Oh, we're going to get the death penalty if we don't go back to the religion of my mom and dad? Mom and dad are pressuring me too." Think it's easy? You think it's easy when Ibrahim, his father figure, Aza, is pressuring him and the entire community worships the same idols? You think it's easy? What happens after that conversation of the star, the moon, and the sun? They say, "We're going to a festival." Ibrahim goes even further and he destroys the idols except for the biggest one. And he humiliates them even further. He says, "Well, you don't see the big one still over there? Go and ask him what happened." "Oh, you can't talk to him, huh?" What happens after that, brothers and sisters? You think it's a light thing that they were discussing over chai and biscuits or something like that? That they went and threw him into a fire? Are you ready to be thrown into a fire? Because I promise you, if you have Allah on your side, that fire will become bardan and salaman, just like it was for Ibrahim. I promise you that just like with Ashab al-Kahf, even the sun will move its rays so that it doesn't hit your cave while you're sleeping. تَزَاوَرُ عَنْ يَمِينِ وَذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِقٌ بِرَاعِيهِ بِالْوَصِيدِ. This is talking about how the sun, when its rays were coming from the morning, it slants a little bit this way so that it doesn't hit them. Then Allah moves their bodies to the other side of the cave and he completely makes the light go dog right, a full sharp right turn. And today is not the time to talk about Surah Al-Kahf. Inshallah, one day I'll even get to that in my tafsir classes. But that's what happens when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is on your side. Physics is under His command. وَأَنَّ الْقُوَّةِ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Power always had been, always will be, with Allah in its entirety. And so therefore tonight we will be looking at one final example of someone who stood up to his people and all of the pressure around him. بعد الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
You know, there was a wa'iz a few years ago in Karbala who one night he went to sleep and he saw in his dream Sayyidatu Nisa al-Alameen Fatimah al-Zahra salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
She said, why don't you narrate the musibah of my son, Imam al-Hasan? He says, Ya bint Rasulullah, I do narrate the tragedies of your son, Imam al-Hasan. I narrate, for example, that when he was only 8 years old and his mother was coming down the street, and a man was coming from behind her and he was whipping her and slapping her. That he was yelling to the man, don't touch my mother. Hit me instead if you want to, but why are you hitting my mother? When Fidda went and asked later on, why, Hassan, do you cry more than Hussein? It's because, Fidda, I was outside and I kept him inside so that my baby brother Hussein didn't have to see this, what happened to my mother. She says, that's not the musibah I'm talking about to the wise. The wise says, but I also narrate the musibah of when he had passed away and he was poisoned by his wife, Ju'da. And when his kafan was going towards Rasulullah, it was white. And when they brought him back to Baqiyah, it was red. And there was a sister sitting next to the grave of her brother. Before that she could go and put her brother into the grave, she's taking one arrow out at a time and crying silently to herself, reminding herself of her mother and her pierced rib. She says, that's not the tragedy that I'm talking about. He says, I also remember the tragedy, Ya bint Rasulullah, of when your son was on his deathbed. And he coughed up his liver. I don't know how he coughed up his liver. This is what the narrations tell us, brothers and sisters. Don't ask me how you are able to cough up your chunks of liver. And when Imam al-Hussein is sitting there next to him, the first thing he says is, Hussein, hide it. Why, Abba Muhammad, why should I hide it? Why do you need me to hide it so quickly? Because I hear Zainab coming towards the door. She says, what is she going to... He says, what is she going to say when she sees you in this state, ya akhi? He says, la yawmuka ka yawmuk, ya Abba Abdullah. She says, that is not the tragedy. Oh, wise. He says, then I don't have any more tragedies that I can remember. Ya bint Rasulullah, what is the tragedy? She says that when my grandson Al-Qasim was on the plains of Karbala, he was sitting in his tent and he was sitting like how a kid does with his knees up and his arms wrapped around his knees and he was crying and crying and crying. On the 9th of Muharram, his mother Ramla was sitting in the tent of Zainab. But you know, when you become a widow and you don't have your husband anymore, a husband like Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, you devote all of your efforts and your time into your son. And so Al-Qasim, at this tender age, this tender youthful age, is sitting and crying, and she senses that he is crying. And she goes and says, Bunay Qasim, what is wrong? What can I help you with? What can I do that might help alleviate and soothe your pain? He says, my uncle Hussein has just read out the list of all of the shuhada of Karbala, and I didn't hear my name, and I want to be there to defend my imam. Mama, why didn't he recite my name? Am I not worthy enough? She says, I will ask your uncle for you. He has a soft spot for you because you remind him of his brother, Al-Imam Al-Hasan, alayhi salam. Maybe if we talk to him, maybe he will allow you. Don't lose hope. On the day of Ashura, he comes out of his tent multiple times, coming, and he's only able to say to his uncle, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah. Each and every single time, Imam al-Hussein cuts him off and says, you know, you are my only last remaining thing that I have to remember my brother al-Hasan with. After you go, if I send you out, what will I have to remember myself of my dear beloved Imam, my Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam? What will I have after you? And al-Qasim cannot reply because he himself has grown up in a household of Imam al-Hussein, where he has been told of the heroic stand that his father al-Hasan held, and how he was so alone that there were no soldiers left to go and defend Imam al-Hasan. And Imam al-Hasan was even betrayed by someone in al-Qasim's household, Ju'da. So he wants nothing more than to be the pride of his father, so that when Imam al-Hasan is reunited with him in Barzakh and in Akhirah, he can lift his chin up high and say, Ya Aba Abdullah, when you were defending Islam, even I gave away everything I had. Eventually, al-Qasim is starting to lose hope and he's crying loudly to his mother that I don't think my uncle is going to give me the chance to even speak. She says, untie then the ta'weez on your arm, because your father had told me, tie this ta'weed to his arm, and when al-Qasim is in his most difficult position, tell him to untie this and read my final words to him. He unfolds the letter, and brothers and sisters, Ya Shia of Imam al-Hasan, what does your Imam say to his son on his final day of life? He says, Bunay Qasim, if you see your uncle ghariban, atshanan, if you see your uncle and he is alone, thirsty, abandoned, like me, give your life so that he does not have to give his life. Delay his death by a little bit. And show this letter to my brother Hussein, and this will be your sanction so that you can go out into war. When he started to read the letter, of course al-Qasim was crying because his father is talking to him. Al-Qasim was only a year old when Imam al-Hasan died 10 years ago. 10 years later, he's with his uncle, and his uncle is in the same position as his father, alone, betrayed by the Muslim Ummah, betrayed by the swords of Banu Umayyah. But by the end of the letter, when he reads that this will be his ticket to go into the battlefield, he has a smile on his face, and he runs out of the tent, and his mother stops him and says, Bunay Qasim, allow me to tie the turban onto your head. I had wished that I could see you be married off. I had your clothes ready so that when you were at the age of marriage, that we could go and dress you up and we could give you this turban. Now let me go and tie the turban the way that Aba Abdullah an hour ago tied the turban of Ali and Al-Akbar. She ties the turban of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi onto her little fragile son Al-Qasim, the way how Rasulullah went and tied the turban onto Amir al-Mu'mineen at the Battle of Badr. With the one notable exception that when Rasulullah was tying every single turn, he was saying, Nasrun min Allah wa fathun qareeb, a victory from Allah, and a victory that is near from Allah. What did Imam al-Hussein tie, saying an Ali al-Akbar that now Ramla has learned? She is tying the turban of Rasulullah, reciting, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un, with every single turn. After she has dressed him up and she is ready to let him go to his uncle to let him bid his final farewell to his imam, Imam al-Hussein starts off by saying, you are my final reminder of al-Hasan. There will be no remembrance for me of al-Hasan because you resemble him most of all. Al-Qasim, with utmost respect, has the courage now to say, my uncle, assalamu alayka minni, please let me enter the battlefield. And he hands him that letter of Imam al-Hasan. After reading this letter, brothers and sisters, Imam al-Hussein turns towards Medina and says, Assalamu alayka ya Imam al-Hasan, ya akhi, even in my hour of need, you did not forget me. You have sent someone prepared to go and defend me in your likeness. How can I defend someone who looks like you? I grew up with you, and now I've raised him, and I'm supposed to send him to his slaughter. But if this is what you wanted, how can I deny my imam? Imam al-Hussein says, I will be the one who puts him on his horse, and I will give him his mail of chain, so that when the arrows come, he cannot be hurt as easily. But brothers and sisters, they only came with the chainmail that was for adults. And so Qasim, with his young body, is wearing something that is completely too big for him, and it is too heavy for him to even move. So now Al-Qasim goes and requests, my uncle, please, let me go without it. Let me go without protection. I am one of the moons of Banu Hashim. I can defend myself. Let me go and kill them. Let me show them what we are made of, our family tree. Imam al-Hussein has no choice. He says, okay, the wajib is upon you to defend your imam. You can go. He goes on his horse, brothers and sisters, and a shaqi of mal'un by the name of Azraq sends out one of his sons to go and battle al-Qasim. One of them is sent to the Jahannam of Barzakh. The second one is sent to Jahannam. Third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seven sons of Al-Azraq die in combat with Al-Qasim until Al-Azraq is not able to take it anymore. He has a hatred for this beautiful young boy. And he goes and says, I will kill this boy myself. And Al-Qasim kills him as well. One of the enemies, the mal'uns of the enemies, says, I will go and rip a tear into Abu Abdullah's heart. This small little flower will die at my hands. At this moment, brothers and sisters, the history tells us that Qasim's left sandal becomes undone while he's on his horse. If you've ever been on a horse and you have been, even momentarily, your foot gets out of the saddle and your shoe falls off, your mind is on there. You don't care about where your horse is taking you, what's happening, where the road is. You just care about your honor. You don't want to look like some homeless person on a horse. So Al-Qasim starts to mend and restrap his sandal. At this minute, brothers and sisters, the enemy of Allah comes up behind him and he strikes him behind his head. And Al-Qasim falls from the horse and crying out, Amma Hussein, please come to my aid and help me. At this moment, Imam al-Hussein runs like a lion to the defense of his nephew, and he kills the murderer of al-Qasim. But while he is in battle with this Shaqi, what happens to the lovely body of al-Qasim? One of the narrations is narrated to have said that while Qasim was still in his final moments and he was still alive and breathing, these enemies of Allah told their horse riders, trample over the body of al-Qasim, dismember and crush his body. We know this happened to Imam al-Hussein after he died. Unfortunately, it seems to have happened in the life of al-Qasim, this poor little young boy. Imam al-Hassan will come on the day of judgment and say, bi ayyi dhanbin qutilat, with what sin was he killed? Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein brings al-Qasim back in this form. And Ramla sees him and she says to Zainab, screeching and screaming, I sent my son Salim with the sound body with Aba Abdullah. What is Aba Abdullah bringing over his shoulder? What is this sack of bones? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ayya munqalabin yanqalibun wal aqibatu lil muttaqin. Raise your hands, brothers and sisters, with these tears in your hands as your shafi'. And recite with me the holy ayah of the Quran 5 times, inshallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. No one should be quiet. Ammai Jibul. Louder, louder, brothers. لشفاء المرضى أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. For the hastening of the reappearance, أما إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. اللهم إنا نسألك باسمك الأعز الأكرم الأعظيم الأعز الأكرم 10 times. يا الله 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 يا الله. Oh Allah, we ask you by Fatima and her father and her husband and her sons and the secret that was hidden inside of her. اكشف عنا السوء يا الله اغفر ذنوبنا كفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار مع محمد وآله الأطهار ولأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والجالسين والحاضرات ولخصوص من أوصانا بالدعاء والعلماء والشهداء. نقرأ سورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.